Por eso, Señor, te damos gracias. Señor, también te pedimos que estés presente en tu espíritu en esta clase, que nos guíes, que nos des el entendimiento, la inteligencia.
There are so many instances in Bible that could be seen people were born of old age, and those people were specially selected by God. No, there are examples we have already seen: Samson, then Samuel, John the Baptist. See, there are so many people like that. So that's also a clear indication that God's special intervention and choice is there in that case. Even though Isaac, they were barren of that age, God's intervention, that shows the sign of God's, you know, the power and mercy towards that person, and for a special selection. Okay. Then something about we have learned about the what we call angelology, you know, who are the angels. And we were discussing mostly about that, the Christian angelology. Christian, Judaic, Christian and Muslim angelology seems to be almost the same. Almost the same. The names are also almost the same, but you know, in the Islam, a little bit Arabicized the names. For example, Gabriel, I think they call Jibreel. They call it like that. So these are some of course, you know, they have more angels. The Hebrew literature, they had so many other angels' name also there. There are many angels' name are they given. At least in the Christian tradition, we have three names from the Bible. And one, they say, from the tradition, that's called Uriel. Uriel. That's a tradition, you know, but that's not that much. And we were discussing about the demonology also, you know, the angels, you know, the counterpart of the angels were the demons. And I, again and again and again, I underline, always say, this is a tradition. How the angels were formed, how the demons were formed, and this is a tradition. This is a tradition. But, you know, from Book of Revelation, there is a part in which, you know, we see the Michael fighting against Lucifer, and they were cast out from heaven to hell. No? Those things we can see a little bit there. But all these, the hierarchies. Did you ever listen to the Hosanna hymn?
Yes.
So just before the Hosanna hymn, when the priest says in the preface, no? To the dominions and powers and the choirs of angels. So we name these names, you know. There are nine groups of angels we have already seen. The first one is starting with seraphim. No? There are three, and then the next three archangels, the third one, the archangels, including archangels, okay? That is the same thing, they say, the demonology, these are the hierarchy of demons too. So, when you say, for example, especially for the kids, this is very, very difficult to, you know, to tell them and then make them believe. But about, you know, angels and these things, these are very, very difficult. And one thing is, there is a belief always, we believe that there is a guardian angel, no? Every one of us has a guardian angel. And we call it, you know, protecting us from evil, protecting us from dangers. There is a guardian angel, we say.
So sometimes he got asleep, right?
Okay. So that is about the angelology. And all the names of angels, when you see, it's all connected with God, no? All the names, for example, Micha, all the angels' names ends with El. Micha, El, Raphael, and Gabriel. El means God. Yeah. In Hebrew, El means God. That's why when Jesus was on the cross, he was crying, El, El, Lama Sabachthani. No? El.
So the other names in the tradition, like the one you just mentioned?
Uriel. Yeah, El. Yeah. All the names are
supposed to be like seven or something like that, right?
Nine.
Nine.
Nine groups.
No, but also sometimes people send you prayers to the angels and they mention way more than the three that we know from the Bible. And one of them is Uriel, and they are some other.
Yeah, that is from tradition, you know, but the Christian tradition mostly take these three.
I thought it was Eli, Lama Sabachthani or something like that.
That's El.
Two words.
El. That is Elohim. God is Elohim.
Who is this?
Just a minute. Eh? Hello?
They changed the translation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. My AC had a problem, you know, so I called, you know, someone to come over and then check with that. That's why I took that phone.
Elohim?
Eh?
Elohim is which?
Elohim, that is the word for God, you know. We call it Yahweh, no? So one word is Yahweh. That is a little bit more personal. So there is another tradition, for example, there is a Yahwistic tradition. This is a little complicated when we learn about Pentateuch. The Pentateuch five books were formed mostly from three traditions. One is the Yahwistic tradition, second is the Elohistic tradition, and there is the fourth tradition, and four is the Deuteronomic tradition.
What's the Deuteronomic?
So that means, for example, that's why we have two accounts of creation. In the Bible, the first two chapters, we have two accounts of creation. That's from two traditions. That means the first account, when we call, you know, that this account Yahweh, Yahwistic tradition, means that's a little more anthropomorphic understanding of God. What do you mean by anthropomorphic understanding? Being God, like, you know, moving like man. In that tradition, for example, after, you know, making man, creating man, God walking with Adam, and then, you know, and all those things, all the fall, all those things were, you know, from the Yahwistic tradition. It is just like seeing or, you know, explaining to people who God is. God is our friend, so he is just like, you know, a very personal thing. That is called Yahwistic. And the name in that tradition about God is Yahweh. There is another tradition in which God is considered to be very transcendental. What do you mean by transcendental? It's beyond. So we cannot say the name of God. We cannot name him. It is Elohim. It's beyond. So there, that transcendence of God is so much emphasized. The second creation account, it is only very very small. That is, you know, God created everything. That's from Elohistic tradition. And these two traditions, you know, always went in parallel. So, and you know, the author of the Pentateuch, you know, took both of them and, you know, composed especially the first two books, Genesis and Exodus. And priestly tradition is mostly, you know, we see in Leviticus. Okay. The book of Leviticus is mostly norm, laws, and what are the things the priest should do, and the regarding temples and things like that. And Numbers and Deuteronomy is a kind of history. And all the things what we see in Genesis and in Exodus, we can again see in Deuteronomic tradition. So these are the four traditions, you know, are put together. So Elohim is the name of God. And from there comes El. El means, you know, God.
It's kind of a nickname.
No, I mean, just like any language, things, there are short terms inside the language.
Yeah.
It's kind of abbreviated.
Yeah, Elohim. Yeah, that is. So that's about, you know, something about, you know, the angels. So let's go now with the Bible. Okay. So verse 5. We are only in verse 5. Chapter 1st. So, first, you know, just look. The birth of John, the announcement. You know, we have seen already all those things. I think the birth of... verse 5, the angel appeared to him. And... Not the five, you know. The first part, from 5 onwards. Chapter 1st, 5 through 20...
Chapter first,
5 through 25.
5 through 25, which is 5. The birth of John the Baptist.
Yeah. So we have something about, you know, angel appearing him. Then, when angel appeared to him, what was the reaction of Zechariah?
Well, he was...
So fearful, no? He feared... And, you know, he fell down on the ground. That was the common belief in Israel. If you see God face to face, you will die. Yeah. That was the common understanding. And that is mostly, that idea comes from Elohistic tradition. That means God is so transcendent and powerful that man cannot see him. If you're supposed to see, that means you will die. So when an angel appeared to Zechariah, so he became so frightened and he fell on the ground. That is, and also, of course, you know, by respect too. And that was the fear, surprise. And then what was the angel's answer to that? Fear not.
Don't be afraid.
Yeah. Don't be afraid.
Fear not.
They were old.
Yeah, fear not. That's always like that, you know. God is not the one who is to be feared. So, fear not. That is the, we can see many times even Jesus saying, fear not. When he was walking on the sea, when the apostle, you know, fear not, I am. But they were caught in fear. That's that tradition, we can see. Okay, and the angel says, a message of joy. Your prayer is heard. Your prayer is heard, of course. We can develop on that, you know, about the theme of prayer, but we don't need to. And then every prayer is heard, you know. We can see. Your prayer is heard. And we can see, for example, when we pray, every prayer is heard by God. The problem is this. We don't understand that sometimes, you know, the prayer is heard. Why?
Because prayer doesn't come, for wish doesn't come true.
No. Now, there are two, three arguments we can say. For example, prayer is heard by, you know, our prayer is all heard by God. But when God decides something, we don't understand that sometimes. God's answer to our prayer, we don't understand that. Why? Because, as he said, you know, We have prayed for something, and if that exactly that doesn't come, we don't understand that, and we misunderstand how God doesn't hear my prayer.
Well, in the know we say that he always answered, but sometimes the answer is no. Why? Because it's not convenient.
Not even no. I don't say that. Even I don't say that no. Maybe a different result than what we expect.
I used to ask personally, but I stopped asking because I realized that God is divine and that He has a plan. and we fit in that plan. And sometimes I feel like when I ask, I'm asking for something that I don't understand to fit in that big plan. So now I just ask for His will. Because anytime we ask for something that we don't understand, I kind of figure like you're kind of lacking faith in God's plan. It's kind of like me questioning my mother, telling me to eat my vegetables, you know, kind of like that. And so I think that's kind of what you're trying to lead to.
I think in this case, you know, we have to see something like this, I think, you know. For example, prayer is for what? First of all, you know, fundamental question is, does God need our prayer?
No way.
It's for me or for us. We are praying, no?
Of somebody else.
Oh, that means, you know, somebody else, me or for somebody else. That means it's not for God. And God has nothing, you know. That's why, you know, even if, you know, we don't pray.
But there is prayers of praising.
Yeah. That's why even if we don't praise God, you know, even if we don't praise God, He's there. And when we praise God, His, you know, the praises are not increased or decreased. When we ask for something, you know, when we ask, you know, for something, for granting, He knows already, you know, from His omniscience, you know, everything is there. And it's not because we are asking God giving, you know. God is knowing everything. Prayer is, it's my relation with God, no?
My conversation.
It's my relation with God. And, for example, as He said, you know, if you are elevated to that step, that's well, good, no problem. You know, if you don't ask anything, you know, God, you know, you will be done. And that you are, that means you are much more in a comfortable position. And many people may not be to that positioning because, you know, they are maybe a little lower in understanding God's. There's no problem for that God, for God. When I ask God, please grant me this. And some spiritual masters say, when I pray, God, grant me this favor. I am preparing myself to receive the God's will. Like that, they say. I am asking a favor. And, you know, the prayer is preparation, you know, preparing myself to accept the God's will when I pray.
Well, the Lord's Prayer is the
prime example. And that is the problem is this. When I pray, for example, God, I want this job. Please grant this job for me. And I did not get that job. Or I'm afflicted with a disease now. I'm asking, Lord, give me healing. And He does not, you know, at least to my understanding, I don't see that, you know, I don't get healed.
What's the matter with praying for rain?
So, this is the problem. So, God's answer to our prayers. God has promised to you, pray, you will be answered. And every prayer has an answer from God. The only thing is that sometimes we don't understand, sometimes we misunderstand, sometimes we don't want to understand. That means, you know, for example, do we have a music here?
Mm-hmm.
It's full of music, no? It's not. Yes. If you very, you know, attend clearly, you can see the music. If you don't see, okay, turn on a radio, you can hear music. It's full of music. Here, no? How many stations are running here? If you put the different radios here, you can see different musics. Why I don't hear it? Because I'm not tuned to that, no? Mm-hmm. If my ears could be tuned to that the wavelength of the, that broadcast. I could simply hear music. No?
Yes.
But I cannot hear now because my ears are not tuned to that wavelength. And I say, there is no music. Can I say that? There is music, but I don't hear. That is the reality, no?
You can say that.
That was very powerfully depicted in the movie God Is Not Dead, because the atheist professor there just, you know, and the young man asked him, why do you hate God? And, you know, and he pressed him on that, why do you hate God? And then he said, you know, I hate God because he took away from me. He took away everything. Well, then the response from the young man is, well, that means God is alive because you hate somebody. You hate God. So he turned it on him. But, you know, it's just like you say, the atheists just turn it off.
You know? That's right.
They're not receptive to that. They're not willing to accept the word of God or what we believe, you know. And so that's why Christianity is in such a... There's such an attack on Christianity. This morning, Ten Commandments have been taken off of Plaza Square. You know, the cross is being removed from public places. Everything, you know, Christianity is being attacked, you know, overseas, you know, in Iraq and everywhere else, you know. There is a real fear of Christianity by those non-believers.
Yeah, sure. This is because, you know, there are so many religions came in, you know, and gone out, you know, for example. The Christianity is the one religion that persisted that long and that popular. Judaism was, you know, before Christianity. It did not become the world religion.
Well, no? I even understood that even the Muslim faith used to be one of the most premier faiths because of its developments, and it just fell because of its radicalness that it came into the faith. It used to be a good faith, but now it's just been...
Yeah, that's...
They never accepted the second covenant.
That is, you know, they have the politicized and everything. That's the main, mostly that. Okay, so, but here is the prayer, you know, the prayer. Now he says, he was praying relentlessly. He and his wife was praying for a child, you know, for the whole life. And even, that is interesting, maybe I think a kind of prayer always was there. And that's why he say, you know, the angel says, your prayer is heard. Now you will have a son. Here comes the contrast now. The contrast. And he asks, you know, how is it possible? Humanly speaking, it's impossible.
Yes.
And he's asking a normal question. And he says, yes, through the divine intervention, it is possible.
But yet, because he has automatically meant that he doubt.
Here is the angel. He says, you know, because you did not believe me, the angel says.
The Virgin Mary has the same question. How this is going to be, since I have no relation with a man? Was that a doubt?
So here is comes, you know, that's a very, very relevant question. I had also every time that problem. The same question was asked by Mary, and Mary was blessed, and Zachariah was, you know, punished.
I honestly think that it's a spiritual thing, a spiritual versus a human thing, because we think things and we see things and we feel things. And then you get it and you process it, like you process the feeling, but she was very accepted, and that wasn't really a human thing. It defied logic, and she said, that's where the humanity of things come in, I think, because she thought it, I mean, anybody would have. If it would have been me, I would have thought the same thing. Like, hey, I haven't had any relations with anybody. How am I going to be expecting, you know? But she accepted it. And it wasn't an acceptance of human, on a human level, it was a spiritual level of acceptance. Mm-hmm.
There's a book that explains it, that, you know, Zechariah doubted, because he says, "For I am an elderly man and my wife is advanced in years." The Blessed Mother asked, how is this going to happen? She's not doubting it. She's asking him, how is it going to happen? Because according to them, they suspected that they made a vow of chastity, because she could have easily understood, well, she's going to have a baby with her and Joseph, and then that'll be the child. But, you know, she said, how is this going to happen? For I do not know man. There's a big difference.
Yeah, and there's that difference, because she says, "Thy will be done."
Yes.
But on Zechariah's case, where he was struck down and made speechless,
yes.
And then the angel says, "This is what's going to happen to you," and so you can, I mean, that would have turned me into a believer, saying, "You know, you're going to be speechless, and your wife's going to become pregnant." So until this happens,
but I
without that speech, I'm going.
I take it in a different way.
Okay.
And Father, he's a priest.
I take in a different way, in the sense, you know, Zechariah was asking, the angels reply, you know, you won't speak until he will be born.
Right.
If you take it as a punishment, yes, it's a problem. But why don't we take it as a sign?
Well, I said, I wasn't saying it was a punishment. I said it was, I
get. No, not you, you know. We are all thinking about, you know, the same question was asked. And Zechariah was punished, Mary was not, no?
Right.
In that, if we think that, then it is a real problem of justice, because they were both were asking the same question.
Yes.
But this is, Zechariah was, asking, you know, how is it possible? What sign I have? And angel said, this is the sign, you will not speak until he will be born. And Mary did not ask for a sign, because he believed.
But even Zechariah fulfills the will even after he starts to speak, because he names the son.
Yeah, that's all. No, that means, you know, the once the message was given and he was, you know, given the sign that you are speechless, it was over, the moment. He took it completely. That means not even, you know, no? Angel appeared, and then he asked, you know, what is the sign for this? And he said, you won't speak. That was it. Then he accepted it totally. That was the,
no? When you say it was a sign, are you saying that there was a sign for others to see?
Others, and, you know, for Zechariah. Oh, mostly, it's he asked for a sign for him. For Zechariah himself, no? And of course, that's if a sign it is for me, it's also a sign for others.
Well, because the angel says, you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled at their proper time. You didn't believe me. So.
The problem is that, you know, the problem is that sometimes, you know, I don't know whether exactly the nuances in Greek, whether it is exactly believe. There is a problem also of translation. And could be also, there could be, you know, very different, you know, for example, as we have seen, that even in time concept, you know, there are two time concepts, chronos and kairos, no? So when we say time in English, there is not that difference. Did we have that difference? When we say time. In Greek, there are two kinds of time, chronos and kairos. So we don't have that difference when we say time in English. No.
No, for us it's mainly chronos. Right? For us it's mainly chronos.
Yes. So, you know, that, not only that, you know, so I think, if we take it as a sign. And, you know, Zechariah was a little bit doubting too. That means, you say this. Eh? So, how can I believe that I am so advanced in age? My wife is also advanced in age. So he was doubting. That's true. And he did not directly ask, you know, but in his mind, what sign I have? And angel gave a sign, not a punishment. Anyway, that's true. It's not a punishment. That's why.
But it also served to show the people, because when he recovered, when he was able to speak, he was an answer to what other people say, like, what do you want to name him, John?
Yeah, yeah.
No, John in the family.
Yeah, yeah.
So when they asked him, he was able to speak, and for everybody, he's like, oh, this is it.
Even before that, you know, when he came out from the temple, and he could not speak, and people knew already there was some appearance. Oh, it says, the Bible says already.
Father, so, also, going into the aspect of the tradition for women and for men in the Jewish society, women were, in that tradition, they were submissive to the man.
That's our Jewish tradition all over the world, you know.
And the men, you know, they're hard-headed.
They still are.
They still are.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. So let us take, you know, when we take it in as a sign for, you know, a birth of a special child, then it is okay, no? Zacharias, what's called dumbness, no? He doesn't speak. That's a sign for him. So because you did not believe God's revelation, you are given the sign to believe. And Mary asked a question. Yes, but she did not, you know, make that, you know, what's called doubt. She believed that she was asking a question. Yes, how can it's possible? And the angel said the answer from God. You know, because it's God. It's all, everything is possible. She did not doubt. So here is the problem. Okay.
He gave an explanation.
Yeah. And so. Because of the doubt of Zachariah, he doubted, you know. And angel says exactly that to also, no? Because you doubted, okay, the sign is given. You know, that's many times we can see that. A sign is given. In many places in Bible, you know, signs are given for, you know, confirming in faith. Many, many places we can see that. So here, Zachariah was given a sign. So it is our problem seeing that as a punishment. Suppose some other signs were given, you know, it would have been easier for us here to understand that. Only thing is that he was not able to speak, we take it sometimes in as a punishment. Then it is a real problem of justice. But the thing is that,
imagine, he was able to hear his wife talking. He won't say a word.
No? You are now pointing something. No. Okay. So, this is about, you know, about the message. Now comes name. Name is John. Usually, the Jewish tradition is to give the forefather's name. It is Jewish tradition. We follow that even now. We have a problem now because of that.
Junior, the second, the third, the fourth.
In my tradition, we give, especially in the Christian tradition, my place, what we call, you know, the firstborn, if it is a male, the grandfather's name will be given, or grandfather or the father. Mm-hmm. That means the father of the father. That means the child's grandfather. From the side of the father, the name will be given. If it is a female, the mother's name. The second child from the mother's side, name will be given, and that goes one after another. That is the way of naming children. And the old, you know, generation people all having in names like, you know.
So every firstborn of every generation will have the same name.
Yeah. May not be, you know, always certain name. It could be different. Yeah, at least, you know, two or three names. There will be two names at least, you know. And then there are for example, we have seen a development in naming. For example, the old generation having all Christian names, very old Christian biblical names. So there is a, in our society, there is a, some kind of a secularization is going on, and many secular names are, you know, coming out. So a new system was adopted. In baptism, the tradition is followed, and he will be called with a different name. And many of us. And when we ask for a baptism certificate with the name, it has nothing to do with the usual name what they have. For example, take one is given the name. One is given the name Joseph, no? Oh, my, it's better, you know, take my name is the same as it is given. My brother's names, you know, the last one is, his name was given George. Because why it is George? Not because, you know, after one or two, after four, you know, father, mother, and father, mother, two, four, then the rest of, you know, will choose anyone, no? Or their brothers and things like that, you know. We are eight. So after four, the names are over. So he's given the name George. But he's called Paul.
Why?
That's why George is, you know, that was because, you know, my father's or mother's one brother is called George. So his name was given. But my mother and father, you know, they wanted to call him, you know, Paul, somewhere or other, you know, and he's known as now Paul. Nobody knows his name as George. But the problem is, when we take a baptismal certificate, the name is given George. So what we adopted now, we do this way. Name is Paul. Baptismal name is George. We adopt that, like that, you know. So why did we say that? So the name, you know, the tradition of Jewish people, you know, that was they're calling ancestral names were given. But for John the Baptist, Zechariah wrote the name John. Then everybody objected. Why? He could not speak, no? Give the name. After the name, he began to speak. So the name is.
Didn't he say the words where he says his name is?
No, he wrote it.
He wrote it first.
You know, he wrote the name. So, you know, he was asked what is the name he wanted to give. So he could not speak. So he took the what's called the slate, and then he wrote it, the name. The name is Gracious. John means gracious. God's graciousness. It is. And he was given. The name was given by God himself. He will be called as John. No? And that, I think, in Hebrew, the word is not John. It is Yohanan. Yohanan, I think. Yohanan. Yeah.
That's the way it's pronounced, John?
Yeah, in Hebrew. Yohanan. So that's Yohan. That is Juan, no?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Juan is Jose.
No.
John. Yeah, that is the little more. I think the Spanish is little more closer to the pronunciation in Greek. No, in Hebrew, Juan. So, Yohana.
Well, John is a
abbreviation
of Johan.
Yeah. Okay. Now, for him. Now, there are certain things noted for him. He says he will be a joy, favor of heaven, and he shall be a Nazarite. Last time you asked the question. He will be a Nazarite. So, Jesus was called a Nazarene, no? These are two different things. Jesus was called Nazarene because he came from the town of Nazareth. Saint John the Baptist was a Nazarite. That means it's a vow. It's a vow of practice followed in Jewish religion. Who is a Nazarite? Okay, we can see, please take. Nazarene means, set apart from everything that is polluting. He should be a Nazarite. Everyone specially called by God is almost like a Nazarite. Samson, Samuel, John the Baptist, all these people are specially called and they were all Nazarite. Okay, Numbers chapter 6, 1 to 21. Numbers 6, 1 to 21. This is 6, 1 to 21 chapter. So it gives a description about what is Nazarene, a Nazarite. Chapter 6. Rules for
where it comes from. Thus, this is where it says that the firstborn will be dedicated to the Lord.
No, that's not. That's from Exodus.
Okay.
This is a separate.
Okay.
This is something somebody was called separated. Mm-hmm. And especially
Samson, John.
Especially dedicated for God. And these people follow these rules. So, which are the rules? Chapter 6, you just...
Abstain from what?
Okay, just, read. Someone?
Who wants to read?
I'll read.
Yeah.
6, the rules for the Nazarite. The Lord commanded Moses to give the following instructions to the people of Israel. Any of you made...
Male or female?
Female who make a special vow to become a Nazarite and dedicate yourself to the Lord shall abstain from wine and beer.
So that means something polluting, no? It is considered to be alcohol, something polluting. So abstain from alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
One thing. Then
you shall not drink any kind of drink made from grapes or eat any grapes or raisins.
The grapes are from which the wine is made. Okay?
As long as you are a Nazarite, you shall not eat anything that comes from the grapevine, not even the seeds or skins of grapes.
That means an absolute prohibition of wine. So there is a possibility, it even that it's okay. I don't take wine, but I take grapes. Even that much is that too strict, that's absolute prohibition. That means okay. Next come.
As long as you are under the Nazarite vow, you must not cut your hair or shave. You are bound by the vow for the full time that you are dedicated to the Lord.
See, that's why, those people, and St. John the Baptist, he did not cut his hair. He was not using, and that is clearly it is said about him. He was living in the desert. He was eating something, those things, and he was neither, with wine nor anything polluted. He grew his hair. Samson, for example.
Yes.
No? He grew his hair. Once that was cut, his power was gone, no? So he would not shave. So only a half part is, Nazarite. Okay, everyone is non Nazarite here.
Here also beer. In all the Bible says beer, wine or beer. And I'm asking because
there's a translation.
Beer was already invented at the time.
No, my Bible says wine or strong drink.
Yeah. So this is
beer.
The Good News Bible says beer. The strong drink means, any alcohol.
Life,
And strong alcohol, that is, Yeah, okay. And Jesus was not under that. And he was drinking wine. Yep. You know that?
No.
Yeah. Okay.
And you shall let your hair grow. Your hair is a sign of your dedication to God, and so you must not defile yourself by going near a corpse, not even that of your father, mother, brother, or sister. As long as you are a Nazarite, you are consecrated to the Lord.
See, that's why all the priests, you know, they have to, you know, kind of under this Nazarite, or the priestly caste. They're almost like under this Nazarite vow. You know, someone who is a Nazarite cannot touch a dead body, even their father or mother. If they touch it, they are defiled. So, and then again, if you are consecrated, yeah.
If your consecrated hair is defiled because you are right beside someone who suddenly dies, you must wait 7 days and then shave your head, and so you become ritually clean.
And say if something happens, for you know, something that happened to what's called, you know, came in between, no, that made you unclean. For example, you touched a body or something like that, you know, these are the ritual to be clean. So you shave your head and things like that, you know, 7 days of severe abstinence and things like that. Yeah. On the eighth day
you shall bring two doves or two pigeons to the priest at the entrance of the tent of the Lord's presence. The priest shall offer one as a sin offering and the other as a burnt offering to perform the ritual of purification for you because of your contact with the corpse. On the same day, you shall re-consecrate your hair and rededicate to the Lord your time as a Nazarite. The previous period of time doesn't count because your consecrated hair was defiled. As a repayment offering, you shall bring a one-year-old lamb.
Yeah.
When you complete your Nazarite vow, you shall perform this ritual. You shall go to the entrance of the tent and present to the Lord three animals without any defects: a one-year-old male lamb for a burnt offering, a one-year-old ewe lamb for sin offering, and a ram for the fellowship offering. You shall also offer a basket of bread made without yeast, thick loaves made of flour mixed with olive oil, and thin cakes brushed with olive oil. And in addition, the required offering of grain and wine. The priest shall present all these to the Lord and offer the sin offering and the burnt offering. He shall sacrifice a ram to the Lord as a fellowship offering and offer it with the basket of bread. He shall also present the offering of grain and wine. At the entrance of the tent, you Nazarite shall shave off your hair and put it in the fire on which the fellowship offering is being burned. Then when the shoulder of the ram is boiled, the priest shall take it and put it together with one thick loaf of bread and one thin cake from the basket into the hands of the Nazarite. Next, the priest shall present them as a special gift to the Lord. They are a sacred offering for the priest, in addition to the breast and the leg of the ram, which by law belong to the priest. After that, the Nazarite may drink wine. These are the regulations for you, Nazarites, but if you promise an offering beyond what your vow requires, you too give. You must fulfill exactly the promise you made.
Okay, these are the, at least, you know, this much Nazarite means, you know, someone totally dedicated and separated for God. And external signs, for example, you know, long hair and unshaved face, without any defiled food and drink. These are the, and you know, suppose, and another thing is suppose something, what's called, if some defilement comes in, then, of course, you know, do, these are the performance of purifications, you know.
But this is by self-offering, yourself. It's not like the father and the mother decide that their son will become a Nazarite.
Could be, you know, this could be also, I think, many times, for example.
If any of you, male or female, who make a special vow to become a Nazarite.
Yeah, but may not be. For example, many times, they were made by the parents. For example, Samuel was given to the temple. He wasn't living in the temple. That decision was made by his parents. Or we don't know about Saint John. We see him preaching in the desert. Whether his parents made that decision or he himself did that. Anyway, that's very clear. From God, there was a clear asking, you know, wow, he will be a Nazarite.
John was touched by the Holy Spirit when he was in the womb of his mother.
Yeah, you know, what we were talking about, you know, yeah, that's a Christian tradition coming in. Yeah.
Do you have to go through some kind of ritual to become a priest?
Ordination. Yeah. Ritual means a special ordination. There is a special sacrament is there. That means all the, what is the ritual of sacrament of the priest is the imposition of hands.
You're asking for him or for back then?
Yeah, for him.
Becoming
a priest. So
the bishop blesses you and turns you into a priest. The apostles would do that too.
Not a blessing, imposition of hands.
That's the right word.
Yeah. That means blessing, you know, you are, we are always, bishop blesses everyone.
Yeah.
Then he is not becoming a priest. That's called imposition of hands with the prayer. So that is called, you know, the ordination ceremony. So that is a ritual of the ordination. Of course, before that, you might have seen all the candidates, you know, just on the floor and invoking the saints, you know, to strengthen, to intercede for these priest candidates to accept the imposition of hands, you know, as a gift of the Holy Spirit.
All the rites, all the rites are the same everywhere?
The imposition of hands is the same everywhere. Imposition.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But in most of the Eastern rites, you know, they don't bow to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Okay.
There's a Latin rite. And in many Eastern rites, they don't bow to the ground, but there are some other rituals. But in every rite, also, I think in every Christian denominations, making priest is an imposition of hands.
Okay.
Because it is in the Bible.
Yes.
So we cannot change it.
I have a question. So the tradition of having a long hair, like Jesus is having a long hair there, is it like, is there a group still that one no more, or is it?
Jesus' long hair is, you know, whether Jesus had a long hair or a short hair, we don't know. Da Vinci made it.
The deal is, that was the way, that was also the way Da Vinci has it. A normal way at that time.
Yeah.
Have a very sharp scissors.
So because, you know, that was people who were dedicated, you know, people who were dedicated God, you know, they were all Nazarites. So
Paul cut his hair in Acts 18:18 also. That's why he shaved his hair, all of it.
Who?
Saint Paul.
Yeah.
In Acts 18:18.
So this is something, you know, about Jesus, whether the face, what we see, Jesus, you know, we don't know exactly whether that was the face, that was the face given by Da Vinci, no? We know that. And exactly, we don't know anything, you know. That's why when the Africans draw the picture of Jesus, it is black. When the Asians draw the picture of Jesus, it is colored and brown. when the Europeans draw, the picture is white. That's better, because you know he is everything for everyone.
They do that with the Blessed Mother too, right?
Yeah, with the Blessed Mother in India. Blessed Mother is not most popular, but sometimes, you know, she is in saris. Blessed Mother in saris. Yes.
I may be mistaken, but I believe every time that the Blessed...
One mistake? I don't think so. Okay. Yeah.
Every time the Blessed Mother has appeared, she appears in the resembling the dress and the mannerisms of the people she is appearing to. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is true. You know, because many times, you know, these things are connected with our social traditions. No, you see Jesus as you dream. That's why, you know, our dreams are always, you know, related with some realities, somewhere or other.
We need to connect with...
Yeah. Some connection somewhere we should have. Yes. So this is called Nazareth. Okay, St. John was a Nazareth. And then he was given the name John. After that, of course, what we see is a beautiful prayer by Zechariah. He was, you know, singing a beautiful prayer, just like Mary was singing the Magnificat.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, and Zechariah was singing a beautiful song, and that is needed to be studied. You know, beautiful it is. Yeah. And that is taken from Bible too. Mary's hymn is taken from Bible, and Zechariah's hymn also is taken from Bible, Old Testament. These are some of the references. Okay? Thank you. We'll continue.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you.